Welcome to A Night for Truth, a series of conversations with Dr. Alice von Hildebrand concerning the work of her husband, Dietrich von Hildebrand, the 20th century philosopher and theologian. I'm Tom Howard, and we welcome the audience to our conversation. We're speaking, perhaps I should say technically, we're speaking of Dietrich von Hildebrand's book, Transformation in Christ, which indeed we are. I might just do a hop, skip, and a jump down through the table of contents, because this topic, transformation in Christ, is a massive and a profound and a virtually all-embracing one. And he touches on such profound topics as contrition, self-knowledge, true simplicity, humility, confidence in God, striving for perfection, true freedom is a big one, holy patience, and so on, true surrender of self. Well, these are topics which reach into every area, every region of the spiritual life, of the moral life, of the interior life. And Dietrich von Hildebrand was graced, it seems to me, with a particularly powerful and perspicacious or shrewd mind. He had a tremendous ability to make elegant distinctions between ideas that in ordinary conversation we tend to blur and muddle together. And he, that is, from my opinion, one of his very strong points is this wonderful ability to, you might say, tease out what would otherwise be a somewhat tangled fabric and set out before us with what one might almost call remorseless lucidity, just unmistakable clarity, whatever the topic is that he happens to be talking about. We have spoken in one or two of our recent conversations about the question of contrition, which, because the root problem of our humanity is not that we are victims, and it's not that we are weak, and it's not that we are mistaken, it is that we are sinners. This is what the Roman Catholic Church teaches, and backed up by Holy Scripture, of course. We have spoken also of the problem of evil in the world, these huge evils about which an individual feels that he can do nothing. And it would be easy to despair in the face of these evils. And yet we know, strange as it may seem, that despair is itself, eventually, if I persist and insist on it, becomes sinful, because in effect, despair says grace cannot help here, or grace cannot help me, or I am beyond the reach of grace. And that, of course, is the ultimate untruth, we might say. The topic which we were leading up to is a difficult one. What happens, or where are we? People who claim to have faith and trust in God, when something dreadful happens either to ourselves or someone we love very dearly, we lose someone or we see a beloved one suffering, either physically with illness or suffering some injustice or some cruelty on the part of others, what happens to faith at that point?
And you pray and pray and pray, and God seems to be deaf to your prayer. And then comes what I'm going to call a trial of faith. Now, in the previous program, I said, quoting my husband, that there's one type of prayer that God always answers. And then when I ask for greater faith, a deeper love, a more profound hope. These are things that he always grants, but he does. I must make an act of faith that he knows when he's doing it. Now, you can use some sort of comparison. Suppose that a child wants something very, very badly, and his mother, who loves the child, knows that it's bad for him. She's not going to give it to him. And the child will resent it and say, if you love me, you would give it to me because I want it so badly. But God knows what is ultimately for my good. But I mean, obviously, these are moments of severe trials, and I'm speaking of real trials. And I found out at the end of my life that when people don't have real trials, they have imaginary trials. I know people who don't God's love because they apply for a scholarship or foundation and they don't get it. Or they're hoping to get funds from someone to make a trip and they don't get it and immediately feel that God is against them. This is childish and laughable. But I speak of severe trials, that is to say the loss of the person you love best. When you feel somehow that your human life is collapsing, you're just falling into a hole. You know, this is the terrible trial of widowhood. To be a widow, to be a widower, to lose the person that you love best, is of course create a situation of suffering in which you're sort of saying to God, why did you permit it? You lose a child that you love. I mean, I can imagine there's such horror taking place. You know that day after day, children are stolen, and then afterwards you discover that they have been abused and they have been cut to pieces and so on and so on. You take rape, you take violence and so on and so on, and sort of say, these are such terrible things. Why does God permit it? Now, there comes faith. I know that God is love. I know that these things are terrible. I cannot reconcile them, but I trust in his love. Cardinal Newman said, 10,000 difficulties do not justify one single doubt. And I know that God is love, and I pray for the grace to proclaim it to the very end of my life. In eternity, I will understand why these trials were sent to me. You take Saint Jean-Francois de Chantal, who was totally despaired at the death of her husband. She was beside herself. She was running in despair and so on and so on. People thought that she was going to die. And then afterwards, you know, this trial was necessary in order for her to meet Saint Francis of Sales and start the Order of the Visitation. And at the end of her life, she understood this terrible suffering was the price I had to pay in order to accomplish God's work. Now, when you speak about the horrors taking place in the world, which should make us cry every single day, we'll come to that in greater detail when we speak about the chapter, Blessed Are Those That Mourn. There's one thing that we can always do, and this is pray. You know, it doesn't matter whether you see that your prayer is heard or immediately heard, but one thing is certain, God always hears our prayers. You know, we pray for those that are suffering. We pray for those that are dying. This is something which is so beautiful in the Catholic Church. I truly do not know about Protestant churches, but I mean that we pray every single day for people of the world that are in need, that are suffering. You know, for people persecuted in Sudan, for what is happening in Kosovo, what is happening in Palestine, and so on and so on. Simply say to pray and to believe that God in his infinite goodness will allow that these prayers will in some way bring these people the grace of dying by saying, my God, I believe in you.
I think that's one of the points which comes through, or one of the themes, more than a point, very strongly in Transformation in Christ. And I think your husband would say, well, that's part and parcel of being Catholic, that is to say, a Catholic, when he prays, is keenly conscious of not just, shall we say, calling out into the ozone or the ionosphere, into the empty heavens, trying to flag down the attention of the Most High, but he's praying with the entire church, the whole family on heaven and earth, in heaven and on earth, as St. Paul calls it, and in participation with our Lord's own high priestly intercession. He draws his body into that so that one is tremendously conscious of being one with this body, this living, interceding priestly body of Christ. I'm reminded of this as I hear you make these comments. I think when I first read Transformation in Christ, one of the notes that he strikes, or this is something which suffuses the whole book, is there's a tremendous steadiness or gravitas, you might say, a gravity not in the sense of humorlessness, but in the sense of something substantial, something almost immovable, like the Rock of Gibraltar. Your husband treats topics like this, tragedy or difficulty or the test of faith, with a realism and a clarity which doesn't hide from tragedy in any sense, and it doesn't sweep anything under the rug or try to tie things up with a pink bow, and yet it stays faithful in prayer. And I must say, it has come to me recently, all of us, anyone, any Catholic, and most Protestants, I think, are familiar with Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning. And I've often thought, but how do you pray that when something awful is happening? Because that sounds like, and is, a paean, an offering of exaltation to God. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. And it struck me, there is, in one sense, a map of eternal reality. No matter what has happened to me, or to my beloved, or in Auschwitz, or in Kosovo, or a mudslide in Pakistan, or an earthquake, the point is, it is always part of the exercise of prayer to exalt in and to declare and to bespeak God's glory. That remains. That isn't toppled as a result of human tragedy. And it was that way in the beginning, and it is now, and it ever shall be. And as we were saying in an earlier program, all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well. It's a witness on our part to unchangeableness of God.
You know, and simultaneously it is establishing a relationship between time and eternity.
Yeah.
You know, all the tragedies that are happening, there is a moment when all tears shall be dried. But eternity, the beauty of God, remains. Now, you know, what is so beautiful about Catholicism also is this feeling of communion, that I don't exclude, we never exclude in any way, people that do not have the fullness of faith. We just wish them for them to share it. But I mean, when they suffer, this is our affair, because they too are God's children. And I mean, this is something which is very much emphasized. You know, one of the things that I would like to stress several times in the course of this program is what Hunter has taught me when I was teaching my students, and then one of them will shout at me and say, well, we are just imposing your views on us, or your ideas. And I've always said, if what I say is true, it cannot possibly be mine. It is ours. If what I say is false, out of charity, you should refute me, but I can clear the patent from my own stupidities. You know, that's my own affair. But if I say something is true, if I say Catholic teaching is true, I don't say that it's mine. It belongs to the world, it is offered to the world, and it is a particular mission of Catholics to share it with others. You see, and it also gives them a tremendous feeling of responsibility, because the more you receive, the more you will have to give. And therefore, I mean, this idea that God's truth is confided to some people who have the mission of spreading it, go to all nations and spread the good news. You know, this is something which is so beautiful and so comforting, when you know that in this fashion, through your prayers and your love and your sacrifice, you can actually help people in need and suffering who do not know you. You know, I always pray for people going to die today, that at the moment of death, they just say to God, I believe. have mercy on me. And that's enough. But you know, somehow I feel this responsibility for the whole world. I mean, it's not Catholicism. It doesn't make you narrow. It should make you the broadness of God embracing the whole world. And I mean, this is a great consolation in moments of trials and difficulties. Let us pray for those who suffer. Let us believe that our humble prayers can make a difference. Because if you die in peace, sort of saying, I accept death, I know that I'm going to face my Creator, His infinite goodness is going to overlook all the things that you have not accomplished in your life. You know, I concentrate more and more on God's infinite mercy.
Yes, I think this is a theme or a note which is struck all the way through this book. Your husband seemed to me, I never met him, but from reading many of his books, a sort of a quintessential Catholic. I mean, he was a massively urbane and civilized and intelligent European. You know, it's a species we don't quite have in America. We're somewhat Johnny come lately here.
Well, some of you do.
Well, it's all borrowed from you. But in any event, his coming into the Catholic faith with its richness of liturgy and of dogma and of spirituality, he seemed to become absolutely at home. I found myself almost awestruck with the way this man, a man of this kind of breadth of sympathy and this profundity of intellect, should find himself so gloriously in tune with the whole of Catholicism. He's always quoting, for example, in his writing, such and such an antiphon or a collect or a prayer or the third Sunday after something or other. He seemed to know the liturgy for the whole year by heart.
From the moment of his conversion until his death, his spiritual food was the Bible and the liturgy.
Really?
And he knew the liturgy in such a fashion, he'd get up in the morning, the first thing that he'd say to me, today is the feast of so-and-so. You see, so, I mean, I learned it through him because, I mean, he lived it. Yeah. He related it to his life. Now, concerning transformation in Christ, I'm going to say something that maybe I never told you before. But when the book was published late 40s, something like that, translated into English, and he got a letter from a psychiatrist in New York, a Catholic psychiatrist, saying, you know, this book is a gem that has helped me cure and help innumerable from my patients. Because God has given him an extraordinary understanding for the complexity of the human soul and all the dangers lurking in our souls. And I mean, this is something which I believe is going to be particularly illumined if we turn to the chapter on true freedom. You know, the word freedom in the United States has a sort of magic sound. You know, people want to be free, and it is a country of freedom, and you're free to do what you please. And so, whether it is true or not, I'm not going to discuss, because it seems to me that there's a tremendous danger right now. You know, that the government takes over more and more and more and actually limits our freedom. But what people are concerned with is mostly political freedom. I can say what I please, when I please, I can do what I please, and no one has the right to dictate anything to me. The type of freedom that my husband was concerned with, and I mean, there you have this long, long chapter on true freedom, is spiritual freedom. And spiritual freedom, if I wanted to give you a very brief summary of what he's going to say, is how am I going to eliminate within myself the innumerable obstacles preventing me truly from loving God, and through my love of God to love my neighbor. And I mean, if you look at the chapter, you're going to see his analysis is of such depth and accuracy. And when I reread the book for these shows, it must be, I believe, the 15th time that I read it in my life, I said to myself, but my goodness, he wrote that book before he knew me, but he seemed to be describing me. You know, because I could recognize so many of my weaknesses, you know, that actually limits my freedom. Now, let us start at the very beginning. Some people have what my husband called a complex about their rights. You know, this is my right. Yeah. And they're constantly on the alert from fear that someone could infringe upon their rights. I mean, he gives an example which I find is very amusing. You know that, of course, don't forget the book was written in Europe. And maybe it applies in the United States, I truly do not know. But you are not supposed to make noise after 10 o'clock. And suppose that for some reason your next door neighbor starts, you know, cleaning his rugs or whatever it may be about 10 o'clock. No, actually, you are in no way planning to go to bed. You are still doing so and so and so and so. But the very fact that he is doing something which is infringing upon your rights, and immediately you call the police and you make a big fuss. Well, in fact, there is no reason for doing it. You see, just the awe, I've seen that many, many times when I was traveling in Europe, a great deal by train, and then you leave your bag on a seat next to the window, and then you go to say goodbye to a friend, you come back, someone has removed your bag and placed it somewhere else, and taken your seat. Some people would start a war and say, you know, it was my right, and I've taken this seat, and so on and so on, and you want to see, you have a big affair. Well, in fact, maybe there's another seat across the aisle which is just as good, but the fact that you feel that you've been infringed upon, that someone has not respected your rights. Well, this, of course, limits my freedom, because all of a sudden I feel compelled to make a scene, I feel compelled to defend my rights when there's no reason for doing it. You see, this is one typical example. And I said to myself, well, so often in life, I got irritated because someone was stepping on my toes when in fact it wasn't bothering me at all. But just the fact somehow that someone was pushing me aside when I felt that it was my right to defend myself. You take another one. I've never heard this mentioned in spiritual books. And I've read good many in my life, but nevertheless, I'm still very ignorant. And this is disgust. Now, this is something that seemed to be tailor-made for me. Because ever since I was a child, I always had enormous difficulties. You know, for example, in school, when a girl was not as well washed as I wanted her to be. You know, in French we have a marvelous expression. When you have black nails, you know, because you haven't cleaned yourself properly, you see your nails are in mourning. Because you always wear black when you go to a funeral, you see. Well, somehow this is something that disgusted me. And when the girl sitting next to me had black nails, you know, hadn't washed herself, or her face wasn't properly washed, or her nose wasn't cleaned, or whatever it was, you see, I would put myself all the way in the corner to make her understand that I didn't want any closeness to her. Now, it is legitimate. Suppose that someone doesn't wash properly and smells. I mean, to be very, very obvious. Or someone is, sloppy or careless or unappetizing. You know, a niece of my husband was very much, you know, there's some sort of a duty, charitable duty, to be appetizing, you know, to not to discuss other people, mm-hmm. but some people don't seem to mind very much. No, my husband said it is quite legitimate that if someone isn't properly washed, that if someone is unappetizing, that someone hasn't taken proper care of himself and so on and so on, you keep your distance. But it cannot be an obstacle to charity. Now, let me give you a concrete example, something that I've experienced. You go and visit someone dying in the hospital. And when people die, physically, they're not at their best. You know, they can be sweaty, they can be smelly, they can be, I mean, if you don't constantly wash them and so on and so on, you know, this is what happens when we are dying. And she was visited by someone who somehow showed her repulsion. And she couldn't help and say, can't you show me some love? Yeah. You know, in other words, suppose that you find yourself, I mean, it can be a child. You know, I can imagine that a mother refuses to change the diapers of a child because it's not the most appetizing thing that you can imagine. You know, it's not terribly aesthetic, but you do it out of love. And you don't say to the child, you're absolutely disgusting, and then you put three pairs of gloves and you hold it at a distance. You know, the mother grabs it and takes it because she loves. So my husband said, we may not allow a feeling of disgust, or, you know, it can be because someone takes a piece and say, oh, you know, this is so good, and gives you food with his or her fork. And you don't want the fork of another person to enter your mouth, and you sort of immediately show your rejection in an unloving fashion.
Whereas, on the other hand, the saints...
Well, you have it.
The feeling, they are at rest, they are at peace. Well, I can see you've done your homework, because you mentioned the first two points in his chapter in the order in which he has them, without looking at this sense of feeling that my rights are being threatened, and secondly, this feeling of disgust. And he goes on, and we will continue with this in our next conversation about Dietrich von Hildebrand's transformation in Christ, the wonderful, finely tuned distinctions he makes about the things which hamper our freedom. Thank you again for joining us for one more conversation in the series, A Night for Truth.